Good evening. We're very glad you've all come tonight. On the part of Evergreen Presbyterian Church, I work here, so I'd like to welcome you all. We're very glad that you come to these events, and our desire is that you would leave here both encouraged, challenged, that this would be a great experience for you tonight. And tonight we have a rather challenging topic, one that people of all times have struggled with, the problem of evil. And so this ought to be interesting, and we're very glad you've come to think through this very difficult issue with us and discuss it. Well, we're going to have Bernie's going to present first, and Bernie is representing the Westside Science and Religion Discussion Group, and Secretary of Humanist Position, humanist Bernie Dehler. Let's give him a hand. And representing the Christian position is Pastor Nathan Lewis. He's the pastor here at Evergreen Presbyterian Church. So let's give Nathan a hand. On the question and answer time, I'd like you to ask, try to be brief in your question. Try to think through, even now, it might be good as they're presenting, if you were to jot down a question, so you can try to be as succinct as possible in expressing your question. And then if the person has not answered your question, or maybe you're not on the same wavelength, we can allow a little bit of play there and going back and forth. But do try to be succinct. Last time we ran a little bit over, probably my fault as the moderator, but I'm going to try to keep it a little crisper moving along, and so we can end at 8 o'clock tonight for those who have small children and those who are just ready to leave. So we're going to start. We're going to give Bernie the impossible task first of, in 10 minutes, presenting a cohesive view of the problem of evil.
All right, so I'm an atheist, and if you're an atheist or an agnostic or lean that way and you might want to find out more information, there's some groups to get involved with locally. And the best way to find those would be to go to meetup.com. There's two large groups in the Portland area. One is CFI, Center for Inquiry, and another one is Humanist of Greater Portland. That's HGP for short, but there's a whole bunch of other ones also, like the Flying Spaghetti Monster, Lands for a Pint, and Atheist, etc., and some other ones. So if you go to meetup.com and type in atheist, you'll find these kind of groups. And if you type in atheist or Christian, you'll find my groups. It's the Westside Science and Religion Discussion Group and also the Vancouver Science and Religion Discussion Group. And I try to make those groups neutral, so they're a learning opportunity. So that's it. Can you give me a 1 minute warning?
Sure.
Okay, thank you. Let's see if I can also set. Okay, so let's go to the first slide. So what is the problem of evil anyway? Well, I'll state it this way. If God is all loving and all powerful, why is there so much evil in the world? So that might beg the question, well, what kind of evil are you referring to? So I got a laundry list here of evils, just on two pages, just to get your mind going on what kind of evils we might have. For example, 1 in 33 babies has a birth defect. By birth defect, by definition, means it's something that's going to severely impact your life. So there's 313 or so million people in the USA right now. So at that rate, that'd be like 9 million people. Might be less than that because one of every five that's born with birth defects actually dies. So, but if they live, that would be about how many there is. Compassion International is a ministry, Christian ministry, that says they say there's 30,000 kids that die every single day of things like malnutrition and diarrhea, things that are easily preventable. There's an earthquake in China that killed 833,000 people in 1556. 1 to 4 million people were killed in China in a flood in 1931. 100 million died from the Black Death pandemic from the 1300s to the 1720s. 300 million people died from smallpox until it was eradicated in 1980. Next slide. 500,000 from a cyclone in the Bangladesh area, 1970. 300,000 from the Indian Ocean tsunami in 2004. 15 to 43 million, somewhere in there, Chinese famine from 1961. I mean, think about that. You know, up to 40 million people died. You know, these are children, grandparents, all kinds of people. Biologists or environmentalists and biologists say that 99% of all species that ever lived are now extinct. Some people will even say, well, it's really like 99.999% or something. There's just so many. And then on the galactic scale, there's galactic collisions. the astronomers think they see some, and they think the Milky Way and the Andromeda galaxy are headed for a collision in about 3 billion years. We have 300 billion stars in the galaxy, and there's about 1 trillion in Andromeda. There's actually a simulation on the internet. You can see what they think it might look like when these two collide. And then personally, everybody has to eventually deal with death. Next page. So I'll make a special note that I read this in a book from Dr. Dobson, or not Dr. Dobson, Richard Dawkins. Two totally different guys. He says this theodicy issue is only a problem for people who believe in God. You know, like Christians, for example, it has nothing to do with atheism, because in atheism, the world is exactly, it operates as you would think there would be if there was no God, you know? So, you know, this, you know, plate tectonics is natural. This is why we have floods and, I mean, earthquakes and tsunamis. Next page. Okay, so originally with the ancient cosmology, it used to be, well, the idea was God made humans perfect in a perfect state. There was this Adam and Eve. They made a disobedience. They disobeyed his command. Because of that, God cursed everything, cursed the world, cursed all of creation. And there's one day it's going to be all redeemed by Jesus Christ, and Jesus now is doing that by redeeming people back to God, and someday he's going to complete the job of the new heaven and new earth. Well, the problem with all that idea is that we now know there's no such thing as a first human. There was no Adam and Eve from whom we've all descended. And we also know that death is a part of the life cycle, so it's not like they introduced death to the world, which some theologies say. Next page. So for those who reject biological evolution, they use Adam and Eve for the basis of their solution for this answer of theodicy. Why is there all this suffering and things? But the problem is there is no first humans, so their hypothesis that this was all caused by the first humans has been falsified. Scientifically, we can say it's been falsified. So all of that theology is now falsified. That's a major point. Even the Roman Catholic Church believes that all humans today descended from Adam and Eve, and we inherited original sin from them. That has been falsified by science. Point blank, I want to say that. It's been falsified. So you can't believe it anymore. They need to reformulate their theology in light of science. Next page. So people might say, oh, what about mitochondrial Eve? I heard about that. That sounds like the first woman. Mitochondrial Eve basically shows that all humans today, if you look at your mom, who is her mom, who is her mom, who is her mom, if you go all the way back, the most recent common ancestor, this is mitochondrial Eve, and they think this woman, I'm not sure if that's a population or a woman, but she probably lived around 190,000, 200,000 years ago. Now, if you look at the Y chromosome, that's like asking who is your dad, and who is his dad, and who is his dad. So all humans today have a most recent common ancestor from that. That's called right Y chromosomal Adam, about 62,000, 142,000 years ago. Okay, so this is what I want you to keep in mind. Mitochondrial Eve's mom, for example, would have been just like now when a parent has a child, the child looks like the parent. There's not a big difference. It's not like a human pops out of an ape or, you know, a chimp or something. They look the same. There's not a big difference from generation to generation. And also, mitochondrial Eve's mom could have had other daughters. So there could have been, mitochondrial Eve could have been one of 10 daughters. They all had children. But turns out all those other bloodlines from the mother died out. And so this one bloodline is the one now. So you might say, well, why do we care about mitochondrial Eve? If she's like her mom, why don't we go to her mom? Well, because this is the definition of the most recent common ancestor. If you go to her mom, that's not the most recent one, because like I said, she could have had other daughters and they would have had other lines and they just died out. Okay, next line, next page. What is evolution? Well, from the University of California at Berkeley, there's a definition right there. It says, biological evolution, simply put, is descent with modification. The definition encompasses small-scale evolution, changes the gene frequency in a population from one generation to the next. And large-scale evolution, which is from a common ancestor over many generations. So basically, this is what they're talking about is micro and macro evolution. And you can see how on the microevolutionary timescale, they're talking about how this happens in populations. No scientist today would say that it's possible that we all descended from one man and woman. That's a severe bottleneck. They think there may have been a bottleneck, but maybe it's down to 1,000 people, not 2 people. So as long as you think we came from 2 people, again, I'm saying that's been falsified. That hypothesis has been falsified. Next page. There's an idea called ring species, and for example, around the Arctic, this number one here shows where there's a seagull, and as you go around, these seagulls mate with each other as you go around the circle, but they change too, there's gene flow. And so what happens is by the time you go all the way around, they started number one in Europe, and by the time they come back in Europe again, there's a different species there, they can't even mate. That's called a ring species. So imagine number 7, you say, oh, interesting species. Where's the first one of the species? There is no first one, because there's a gradual change here. So it's the same thing with humans. And then this ring species, there's many other examples from animals we see too. So this is just one with a seagull. Next page. Richard Dawkins makes, here's a book he came out with, and he talks a lot about this idea that there is no first human. It's a very important topic, and so he spends almost like a chapter length on with 2 different thought experiments to try to get this point across. Next page. So evolution, I see it as being red and what they say, red and tooth and claw. Poetically, you can say the claws and teeth of a cheetah have sculpted the grace and speed of the antelope. Just think if you think of antelope as really beautiful and graceful, it's like, yeah, that was sculpted by teeth and claws. That's evolution. The predators, they gain speed, sharper teeth, sharper claws to kill, camouflage, things like that. And then the prey, to try to stay alive, they gain speed, thicker hide, horns for defense, camouflage. A skunk, for example, could develop a stink. You know, there's different things they come up with. Next page. So some evangelical Christians now, for example, Dennis Lamoureux, theologian, he says, yes, it's a fact, and now let's deal with it. So he tries to rework theology. Let's go to the next page. I'm not going to have time for this one, so the next one again. Next page. And here he basically says, to conclude then, coming to terms with suffering and death is never an easy or comfortable process. And so it's usually heart-wrenching, humbling experience that leaves many of us intellectually and emotionally drained and unsatisfied. And I'm thinking, you know what, if you have the truth, you shouldn't be emotionally drained and unsatisfied from it. You should be happy about it. So anyway, he basically says that all this clawing and action and everything gives glory to God. It's not evil, it's glory, because I mean, look what it resulted in. It resulted in making people who are spiritually fit to inherit heaven. And I'm thinking, what do you mean spiritually fit people to inherit heaven? What about the children who died? They didn't have a chance to get spiritually fit. What about all these people, thousands and millions of people who died in earthquakes and everything? So it seems kind of egocentric, I think, to say, you know, oh, well, it's all about me and my development, you know, because I'm a healthy person and all that. I mean, it seems pretty, what they call anthropocentric or centered on human ideas. How much time do I have left?
You're past time.
Okay. Just summarize in 30 seconds?
Yeah.
Next page. So in summary, I just want to say to be a truth seeker that I want to admonish everybody to treat to seek the truth above all else, above everything, even devotion to God. Because if God really did make you and gave you brains, he'd be happy like any parent is happy when a kid brings home good grades from school. There's no way you can insult God by using your intelligence. And so use your brains to the maximum capacity. And Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, the life. So if he really is the truth, then when you seek the truth, you'll find that. And if it doesn't work out, then he basically shot himself in the foot. So I'll go with that. Thanks.
In lieu of my advertisement, good night, Denise.
Yeah.
Thanks for helping out. I want to alert you to the DVDs of past forms if you're interested. Robert has been working in the back to help us record and produce. Some of the past topics of the forum have been, did Jesus really have no biological father? Did Jesus rise from the grave? Just can't stop talking about Jesus. Must you believe in good to be a genuinely moral person? And was Jesus perfect? I told you, Jesus just gets in all the time. If you're interested in any of those or more, Robert has them in the back for $5 a piece. I think you have them online too, public access?
YouTube channel, yeah.
YouTube. It's you can go to YouTube and get them for free if you like, but if you want the convenience, there they are. I'm going to, in my 10 minutes, give you a whirlwind tour of John Frame's two chapters in his book titled Apologetics to the Glory of God. And he has two chapters on the problem of evil. And I'm not going to go right in order. I'm picking and choosing, especially to try and interface with Bernie's good presentation of all the evil and the prevalent evil in this world. And so Frame writes, for example, it is also useful to bring this point to the unbelievers or the non-Christian's attention. He or she, in a way, has a more serious problem than the believer does. If the believer faces the problem of how there can be evil in a theistic world, the unbeliever faces the problem of how there can be either good or evil in a non-theistic world. In terms of the larger apologetic enterprise, this sort of truth needs to be driven home to the unbeliever. And so all of the slides describing evil before us tonight, that's our world. And we have to live together, Christian and non-Christian, and decide what we can do and what we cannot do about the evil that is here in the world. It's actually quite refreshing for me to counterpoint with someone who believes that there's a lot of evil in the world and that the human race is fraught with a lot of problem. Because oftentimes, secular humanists will argue that that the human race is has a bright and positive future. But atheism, joining hands with secular humanism, has turned that around just in the last decade. I don't know if you realize that. But my grandmother's generation lived with a very positive view of the world without God because the human race had so much potential. But now we're coming around just in a quick decade to see that the human race is fraught with problems and is at the very heartbeat of evil in this world. And you know, the Bible has quite a bit to say about the problem of evil. There are a lot of discussions. The entire book of Job is a classic presentation of the problem of evil. It comes up in Paul's epistle to the church at Rome, titled Romans. It comes up there several times. The answers to the problem of evil that are given in the scripture, I don't think satisfy anybody's curiosity or anyone's deep concern about evil. The answer is quite surprising. And I'll get to the answer, the biblical answer, hopefully at the end of the 10 minutes. But I must say, because the answer that the Bible gives is so offensive to most human beings, the church has, throughout history and in the present, tried to come up with all different kinds of other answers to the problem of evil. And this has complicated the whole situation. So let me just let me say before I give you some of those Christian answers to the problem of evil that I find to be unsatisfactory. At the center of the Christian faith and practice, and at the center of the biblical narratives, is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so the problem of evil is right at the center of Christianity. If you think about it, the Bible claims that Jesus Christ was the Son of God, infinitely perfect, infinitely innocent, infinitely free of evil, and yet he receives the cruelty of humanity. He's crucified on a Roman cross. And so right in the very center of our faith, We have the problem of evil. Is God just? Is he good? Why would he allow all of this horrible stuff to happen? Why would he allow his son to be crucified? And so it is that Christians have really struggled with this, as Bernie has said. There's a lot of different answers. The most popular answer is the free will defense. You can read quite a few theologians and popular Christian writers talk about free will, that God created humanity with a will to choose, to make decisions, and it's human freedom that has caused this. The problem with this is that in the scriptures, when the problem of evil is discussed, the answer is never given, well, it's human will. For example, the prophet Habakkuk, he starts his prophecy, which is a dialogue with God, and you can read it, by the way, in just 10 minutes, and it's a great read. But his first concern is he asks these questions of God about the problem of evil, and the thing that's really troubling him is in this question: why, O Lord God, have you allowed me to see the evil? And you know what's really interesting is by the time the dialogue is over and God has answered Habakkuk's questions, Habakkuk realizes that he's a member of the human race. And so he can't have this condescending tone. Why, God, have you allowed me to see this evil? And so God tells him, first part of the answer, I use evil instruments like the king of Assyria to punish my people for their idolatry. He is so puffed up in his pride that he thinks he alone has wrought this evil by his own hand. But I'm here to tell you, Habakkuk, that it was my hand that drove him to do it. You can live like the puffed up king, or, God says in his part of the dialogue, you can live as the righteous man, and the righteous man shall live by faith. This is picked up in the New Testament by the Apostle Paul, saying that every Christian needs to have this weak, humble position, that we would come to any problem humbly and say, I will live by faith. See, it's not a very good, it's not a good answer. Some of you would say you don't like that answer. Well, this is the better answer in Scripture. In Romans chapter 3 and Romans chapter 9, Paul takes up the human litany and asks the questions of the problem of evil. And he says, why have you allowed this evil to happen to your people, your chosen people? And the answer that is supplied in Romans 9 is, who are you, O member of the human race, to talk back to God? You like that answer? In other words, the scripture always puts the responsibility back on the human being and says, God is larger than you. He is the one who owns everything. He is the one that is in control. And he does not owe you an answer to your question. And so it is that the free will defense is never used in the scripture as the reason. There are other defenses made. The divine weakness defense. Well, the reason why there's so much evil in the world is that God is not all-powerful. He is not everywhere present. God is a really kind individual, and he loves you a lot, and he would like to do everything possible to help you, but he can't. The problem for the Christian is that the scripture never says that about God. The scripture tells us that God is omnipotent, all-knowing, and that he shall surely have his decrees come to pass in history, that all of his promises are yes in Jesus Christ. You see, God is going to do his thing. Do I have more than a minute yet?
You have 2 minutes.
Nice.
Minutes, I give you what I gave Bernie.
Yeah, that's right. Good. Thanks, Bernie.
And
so, believe it or not, there are a lot of Christians who go for the unreality of evil defense. And they'll tell you, and this just rankles a lot of non-Christians, and I'm here to tell you that I have been a Christian as long as I have memory. And it really rankles me. And it rankles millions of Christians. The unreality of evil defense is to try and make something good of every evil that comes along. But this is what Richard Dawkins does. He says, look at all this evil. You know what? It's just part of a world without a God, because God doesn't exist. And it's just part of the natural unfolding of things. So you don't have to really worry about it. You don't have a problem. Richard Dawkins, we have a problem. This world is full of large-scale evil, genocide. One example, it's full of micro-evil. A woman being raped, a woman being gang raped, trafficking on Backpage.com. We've got a problem, and we all own it as members of the human race. And so it is that there are all sorts of other ones. The best possible world defense given to us by the great philosopher Leibniz, who said that even though this world is full of all of its evils, it's nonetheless the best world which God could produce. Well, as Bernie said, that's not what the scripture says. The scripture says that God gave to us paradise, and he will give it to us again. And so all of these are unfair. Even this ad hominem defense is unfair, but I think it does have a point. Some Christian apologists say that there's this whole group of people who say there's no God, and so that the world is governed either by chance or by impersonal laws, neither of which command the loyalty required by moral values. But if, like the non-Christian, Christians seek to live and think without God, we have no basis for identifying or describing good and evil. When the unbeliever questions the consistency of God's sovereignty with his goodness in the face of evil, this apologist replies that the unbeliever has no right even to raise the question, for he cannot. On which basis does he raise the question? How does he distinguish good from evil? This is a really good point, but it's an ad hominem point, because it doesn't answer the problem of evil. It's not fair for me to say, when the question is, what is the problem of evil, to turn to Bernie and say, well, you've got a worse problem, because you don't even know how to determine good or evil, because you've thrown out the Ten Commandments. You see the problem? That's called an ad hominem argument. And so we can't use that, but it's a good point. If you're not a Christian, if you're not a theist, then you have to deal with the problem of evil. Don't allow Richard Dawkins to allow you to stick your head in the sand, because ostriches don't even do that. Human beings do that. And to ignore it puts you in the same category as Christians who say, oh, evil's really good because something good will come of it. The scripture doesn't give to us the right to do that. The scripture says, mourn, weep, long for it, cry out to God. You put your faith in Jesus, and you will see the new heavens and the new earth. You will.
You're over.
I'm way over. Thank you very much.
I am in a dilemma sometimes. I am biased, and I think of all the sorts of good questions for Bernie, but not Nathan, and so that's not fair. And so I think we should just go on right now with your questions at this moment.
There's three things, actually, that you brought up that I'd really like to address. One of them, the most simplest one, is you said Dawkins has a problem with evil, too. But the point is, yeah, we're dealing with evil in this world, but here's the problem, that the reason why atheists don't have it. The problem is that we see the world is very evil, but God is supposed to be all-loving and all-powerful. So if you don't believe there is a God, that's why there's no problem with it, evil. It's an intellectual discontinuity between the idea of a loving God and all the evil. I mean, this loving God is supposed to be overlooking all this evil. How can he do that? That's, you know, seeing millions of people die, millions and millions and millions of people die. So that's why it's not a problem for the atheist.
Right, and my point on that, Bernie, is that there's a greater problem. The problem that is really plaguing us should not be who's to blame. You know, this is the second great playground. Who's to blame for this? What about the real problem? The problem is evil. And the Christian knows. Well, it is, because the Christian has a solution to the problem. It's God. And the atheist doesn't have an answer to the problem. See, the Christian believes that God has given to us and will give to us more and will do what we cannot do, but we all become his agents and instruments to fix the problem.
Okay,
the atheist doesn't have that.
Let's move on to another one. I have people in the audience here. Let me just summarize my position, and you can do it on yours, but what I'm saying is it's not a problem for the atheist, because if you don't believe in God, the world is as you expect to see it. And if you believe in God, he's all-loving, all-powerful, how could this world be this way if he's in control and sustain it? So we'll leave that for...
Right, but I just want to say in the dialogue then, Bernie, that you have a view and a practice that is built on resignation. See, Dawkins philosophically and religiously has resigned himself. It's almost like, hey, this world's evil. Get used to it. The problem's still there.
Well, okay, this is what we need to talk about, because I don't think it was a problem for the atheist. So another thing, as you said, this thing about how can atheists even talk about good and evil? I mean, you need God for that. Well, it's actually a very simple answer to that. In philosophy, there's moral systems. For example, one moral system is called divine command theory. That means God said it, what's right and wrong, you don't judge it. If God said do this, you do it. That's what's right and wrong. You don't think about you can't judge God whether it's right or wrong. If he says do it, you do it. There's other systems. For example, in my moral system, I consist of three things. One is consequentialism, which means looking at the outcome to see if it's going to cause more pain or pleasure. If it's more pain, that's bad. Why? Because it hurts, and that's not good. And if it causes more pleasure or flourishing, that's good. Another aspect to look at is reciprocity. You know, don't do something to somebody that you wouldn't want them to do to you. Let's see if I can remember the third one. Individual rights. You know, in other words, you know, do whatever you want as long as it doesn't hurt anybody else, kind of thing. So I usually put every moral question through that, looking at outcomes. So it's really quite simple. So the people who say, like, well, you need God, and I think they go to this divine command theory where, why are the Ten Commandments good? Because God said it. I don't need to justify it, and I can't.
So is that a question to me, or are we dialoguing, or?
Yeah, I'm violating the rules, sorry about that.
Yeah, so just to respond to that, Bernie, it's not quite simple. What you just described is not quite simple. For example, you had as much difficulty coming up with your three rubric for your morality grid as Christians do reciting the Ten Commandments. It's not that simple, because you individually cannot do this. You have to try and build a community that will agree on those things. Just, you know, when you mention the utilitarianism of Jeremy Bentham, and you say pain, that's a good cue that this is evil. You know, enjoyment, that's a good cue.
Sure.
That is not readily agreed upon, even in this small group.
Actually, I would disagree. I think if you look at any court case where they say, how should we make a law, it always comes down to how is this going to affect things. Like gay marriage, one side's going to argue it's going to wreck the society. The other one's like, no, it's kind of like individual rights. So these are the things that they say. In court, they do not allow, oh, well, God said it. Oh, really, who's God? Which God? Which sect are you from? Your sect is going to have the right way on this? They always talk about consequences.
Oh, and no court of law that I know of, even outside the constitutional United States of America, allows anyone to come into court and say, these are the three moral rules that I live by, so you must judge me by those. There's always a codified law. It's nationalistic, or
yeah.
Now it's international.
But I'm saying when they look at and make laws, they go by consequences. That's how they judge it. That's how everybody judges things.
Oh, no. You're mistaken about law on that, and I'm not even an attorney at heart. But consequences is tied to the sentencing, the punishments, the deterrence.
Okay, one more thing I want to bring up. It's interesting in Job, you know, all these things, bad things happen to him, and he finally asks God, why is this happening? Basically, God's answer is, who are you to ask? So it's like, I don't have the answer to you. And then in Romans, it's kind of interesting, too, where Paul says, you know, God's going to harden some people. He's going to harden the heart of Pharaoh. And then you say, well, who are you to talk back to God if he says that's the way it is? It's like, oh. In other words, you can't question God. If God says it's right, that's it. And I mean, sorry, can't use your head.
That's right.
You know?
That is consistently the biblical view.
So here's my question for you. Is that teaching you as a Christian not to use your head and think about God?
No. No, I can think, but I must admit, the most difficult thing for the human is not to think.
Well, let me put it this way.
The difficult thing is to submit to a higher authority.
Let me put it this
way. We all have to do it at some point in our lives.
Are you able
to submit to an authority?
Are you able to judge the character of God yourself?
No. I do not judge God. He judges me. That's the definition of God.
What if somebody's worshiping an evil God and you say, look, man, use your head, that's evil things. And he goes, no, I cannot judge God.
Well, first of all, I don't understand. What I would do is I would take the very words of God revealed to me in the scripture and I would apply them to how I live. And I would apply them to other people, but I would not force that upon other people. But I would say, yes, I believe that what God says is just and right and true. What you would say to them apparently is, what I say is just, right, and true, is true, right, and just. So you've got a problem on an individual level. I'm trying as a Christian to submit. I'm trying to submit to members of my family, members of my church, members of my community, and ultimately God.
But when you get pretty old, as a moderator, right now it's more one side, we've got one hot seat and one going on, and so I don't want to mix the two 12 minutes this way.
Oh, yeah.
And so it's got to go the other way now, but in 7 minutes, going one direction.
Okay, well, yeah. You have this red in tooth and claw slide, where you say the claws and teeth of the cheetah have sculpted the grace and speed of the antelope. And you actually waxed eloquent for a while, thinking, isn't this wonderful how this rough and destructive force between animals has created something beautiful. And then just maybe 3 minutes later in your presentation, you attacked Christians for a view that I actually dismissed in an academic way, which was, all of the evil in the world is actually good because it brings trials and tribulations that purify you and make you spiritually better. And so I'm having a hard time. Maybe you can explain how you can hold these two contradictory ideas where for the cheetah and the antelope, this process of cloth and teeth is really wonderful and has a good end, and so the teeth and claw and all of that must be good because it has a good end. But why wouldn't that be the case for the Christian view, as you say it, but I say is an erroneous one, that through all of this evil, you're made spiritually a better person?
Well, there's two things. First, the first thing is, how can you say all this evil is making you a better spiritual person if you're killed at 1 year old or 2 years old? How does that make any sense? If there's millions of people killed in a flood, how does that make you a spiritually better person?
Yeah, I guess I'm asking you then to apply that same criticism that you have, which I share, to the claws and teeth of the cheetah have sculpted the grace and speed of the antelope.
Yes.
You get my point?
No. Okay, so basically, that's just a fact that if you look at the gazelle, it's a very graceful animal. That thing was sculpted. I'm not saying it's beautiful or is lovely or that's a perfect design, but I'm saying that's the way it happened.
Yeah, see, so in our forums, we keep coming up in our forums to this problem. We have an ontological, and we have a semantic problem. The difficulty is understanding language, understanding logic, understanding how things go together. And I just don't know if you get it at this point, because you can't say it's good for the cheetah and the antelope, but it doesn't hold true for the human
being. I never said evolution is good or bad. I'm just saying that's what happened. I didn't say evolution was good. I mean, it sure is nice that I'm here, but there's all kinds of worms and everything else.
You can't say something is good or bad from your worldview. Tell me how it is, again, that you can say something's good or bad?
Yeah, like consequentialism, reciprocity, and individual rights. You can give me any situation, and I can try to filter it. Some of the more obvious, rape obviously is bad because it's, by definition, sex against a person's will. That's kind of a no-brainer. It's not like it's an absolute value, it's just that it's a no-brainer.
But I derive a lot of enjoyment out of that. See, I derive a lot of enjoyment out of raping anyone that I care to rape. It's a lot of fun. No pain for me.
You're saying
No, I'm not. I'm trying to show you the idiocy of Jeremy Bentham's utilitarianism.
Here's the
you can't say pain, yeah, evil, enjoyment, good.
Well, no,
Jeremy Bentham has opened up the door for sadomasochism.
Well, no, actually you're misapplying it, because you're looking at it on an individual basis. You should look at it as a third party. For example, you can look at, suppose this person wants to do that. What's that going to be like in the community? You don't say, like, what, for me personally, do I want to rape somebody because it's going to make me feel good? You look at, what if there's a person here who wants to rape somebody? What's that going to do to the community? What if that's my wife? What if that's my daughter? I don't want that kind of community. That's bad. So so that was basically your problem in analyzing it, is that you didn't look at it from a third-person perspective.
Oh, yeah, that's clarifying, because when I asked you about your moral grid, you gave to me an individualistic answer. So that's clarifying.
Well, there are a lot of different philosophical systems for ethics, and so that's why I'm saying this is divine. There's a lot of people that have different ethics. And divine, like I said, divine command theory is one of them, where you just don't even use your brain at all and just say, God said it, so I just do it. And
yeah,
I think that's the worst of all.
And even though this doesn't...
Just 1 minute.
Okay, so it really isn't a part about the problem of evil, but your ring species. Tell me why there's no emphasis in the fact that these species are connected. As they go around the globe, they are connected.
Mm-hmm. Right.
They are connected, and that seems to be lost in your argument.
Well, just like humans are connected to all of nature, we're all connected.
Yeah. Right, so that's lost in your whole analysis, which is quite faulty, and isn't what responsible science has said from paleontology, for example, or even the geneticists have not said what Richard Dawkins has said in your support of that. But it's the continuity between the species that is also part of micro and macro evolution, which seems to be lost as a nuance in your presentation tonight.
I'm not sure what you're saying there.
I didn't think you were.
Okay, that's my point.
All right. Now it's time to let you all have your own time to ask questions. And there are mics placed throughout. And once again, I just ask you try to be as concise as you can in your question. And if you need to, if the response isn't adequate, we'll give you a chance to follow up. All right. First one up, Jeff, go ahead.
All
right. I'm sorry, I never clarified this. Please start off your question saying who you're addressing your question to. That helps.
Okay, question for Brent. You said a couple times that evil doesn't make sense if there's a God, or if we have a problem if there is a God or there's evil, but if, this is just a question on consistency, if the Christian God is true, and the Bible is accurate, would it be irrational to see the type of evil in the world today that we see, based on what the scriptures say?
Well, that's the whole problem with evangelical Christianity, because, I mean, some people say, like, Adam and Eve, their sin introduced death into the world. That's the young earth creationist. Older earth creationist says, no, there's death long before that. And then the evolutionary creationists, they fully accept evolution and say there was no Adam and Eve. I mean, the whole story is a myth intended to teach you theology. So there's no such thing as what the Bible says. It's what's your interpretation of the Bible.
Okay. So just a strict literalist interpretation of the Bible. If we just read it for the black and white for the words that are there, where
right,
there was an Adam and there was an Eve, and then evil came into the world at the fall.
But see, that's the thing, though. Hold on, let me finish the question. Okay.
If all I'm asking is not whether Adam or Eve is real, right, just would it be inconsistent for there to be evil in a world where the Bible is accurate and true?
Yeah, I think if, you know, like for the, so for example, the young earth creationist perspective, I can have her answers in Genesis Ministry at the Creation Museum. So I think from that one, there is a lot of sense. There's still a problem of evil, but a lot of it is explained by our first sin that we inherited from Adam and Eve. But I'm saying, why would you even want to consider that? Because it's been falsified.
So if Adam and Eve is true, mm-hmm, then we would expect to see evil in the world, the type of evil that we see today in the world.
doesn't make sense, but that would make that might make sense if that was true, but it's a fantasy.
Irrespective of whether you believe it's true
right.
or not,
right.
It makes, in the argument, it's logical to assume that there would be evil
right.
if added into your
brain. Yeah, and I think, well, I'm not sure if it makes total sense, but it makes a lot more sense, and this is the reason why there's a crisis now in evangelical Christianity, I think, because of evolution being so much accepted now. It's, among academics, there's a crisis because of evolution, which a lot of people don't know about. And this is what's going to get filtered down to the churches. Ever since the human genome's been decoded in the year 2000, they've decoded all these other genomes and have seen all this evidence. This is something that theology never had to deal with ever in all of history.
What was the man's name that did the genome?
Yeah, Francis Collins.
Francis Collins.
Yeah,
he's an evangelical Christian.
He's also an evolutionist and doesn't believe in this little Adam and Eve. So.
We don't have a rush to the mics. Now we do have another person approaching it.
So I have a very odd question. I'm going to address it first to Bernie, and then maybe we can pick it up if you like. The question is, I understand, Bernie, your utilitarian consequentialism, the idea of determining what is evil. My question is, why is evil bad? What's wrong with evil?
Well, see, basically, again, the question is, what is good and bad? And bad is just things that bring pain, and good brings pleasure. Then you say, what is evil?
No, you're missing the point. Why is it bad? Why should we care?
It's bad because it causes
pain. Why do we care about what is evil? In other
because
words, I understand you have a way of deciding that things in this class, in this group, are evil, and things in this group are good. I understand you have a way of determining that. What I'm asking is, why should it matter? Why should you care? Why shouldn't Nathan be a rapist? Why should it matter?
Because it's going to hurt people.
So? What's wrong with that?
It all comes down to pain and pleasure.
So? Whose pain? Whose pleasure? Why should Nathan care? Why should he care?
Because we want to minimize pain.
Why should we minimize pain?
Why should we minimize pain? I mean, is that a serious question? I mean, I'm sorry.
That's a serious question.
I don't understand why that's even questionable, why you should minimize pain. Because it hurts. Everybody knows it. I don't understand why it even poses a question.
Well, because evil is compounded on evil. And when evil compounds, it's not altogether clear to everyone what is pain and what is pleasure. Take for me, I've been a minister for 25 years now. A lot of people don't know the difference between the two. The Christian answer to your question, Charlie, is because evil is what violates God's law. When we know God's law, take the summation of the Ten Commandments. When you break the Ten Commandments, you are committing evil. When you go against God's law, you are participating in evil. That's the Christian answer.
So the problem is, though, there's so many modern problems now that we have moral issues with that aren't in the Bible, and so I think Christians are going to argue with each other.
Let's start with Bernie here, because both of you had a chance to answer, and we have other questions. Scott?
This question for Bernie. Why should we minimize pain? Seriously.
Okay, but you get to keep talking. I think it's
go for it, Bernie.
We have a moral obligation.
Well, let me ask a question here.
I want you to answer my question. Seriously, don't ask me a question. Answer the question I asked you.
Why should we minimize pain?
Why should we? Yeah.
I think the emphasis is on the word "should." Am I correct? Scott, emphasis on the word "should." Is that what you're saying? Why should we?
That's a moral requirement?
Well, the simple answer is because it hurts. We want to eliminate hurt.
So
there's more pleasure that way. If there's less hurt, everybody's happier. That's what morality is all about.
So I have a moral requirement to minimize pain because you say it hurts.
If you're doing anything and it hurts somebody, then you have a moral obligation to stop that.
Why?
Because that's the foundation for my morals.
That's the foundation for your morals?
Yeah, it's all about...
So why should I care about that at all?
Well, tell me what your foundation is. I mean,
it doesn't matter. Why should you take your moral requirements, your moral system, and impose it on me?
Ultimately, it boils down to this. Either it's about pain and pleasure, or it's about divine command theory, which means God told you, don't use your brain, don't think.
Say, my morality is not mixed right. Any problem with that?
It's what?
Mind makes right.
Yeah.
Okay,
it's
so
different than yours.
So look at it from a third-person perspective. Do you think if some guy out there says, my morality is mind makes right, would you say that's good?
Is there a problem with that?
I'm asking you, because that's your morality.
I'd say it's different than yours.
Well, I would think if I say that's okay for another guy, well, then he might use his mind against me, and I wouldn't like that.
So
I would say that's inconsistent.
So what? I mean, why does that become a moral requirement for me?
Well, you can have any kind of moral standards you want to, but then we'll analyze it and say what makes the most sense.
Yeah.
So if you want to say mind makes right is better than mine, then we can do some analysis and say, here's the situation. Let's put it through the ringers and see which one has the best answer.
And, you know, as far as this pain thing goes, I've had surgery before. That's painful.
Right.
But I did it.
That's right.
Yeah, but it's painful.
Because the reason why is because the outcome is greater than the pain you go through.
Oh, so it's not always just to eliminate pain.
It is, but the greater good is pleasure from the pain.
But so sometimes the greater good does justify the pain.
No, for example, is it bad to cut somebody? Well, if you're just cutting them for the heck of it, that's bad. But if you're doing it to remove a tumor or something,
so it's not just about elimination of pain, is it?
It is, overall.
Well, but you said there could be other bigger things. It could
bigger
be pain that could ultimately lead to more good.
Right. So we're going to look at the net effect. Is
it not
effect?
I don't mind. I don't mind letting it go. As long as no one else goes to a mic, you need to know the rules. If you're wanting a mic, that's your cue to say, hey, let's...
Well, one question I want
okay,
to ask...
Okay, so
one thing I was just going to say, I think it would be interesting to ask the audience to raise your hand if you have a question about not understanding that pain and pleasure as an ultimate basis of morality, to raise your hand if you have a problem with that. Not understanding that.
Yeah, I have a problem with that.
It's everybody has different concepts. His concept differs from yours, which
I want to make sure the mics are speaking. People that go to the mics go first, and so I'm gonna.
But that was a good point.
It's a good point, but if you'll step to the mic, I'll get you in. You're a lady, and I tend to be a gentleman, and I give ladies right away before. I'm gonna go with John over here, left. I think he's up first. And then John over here, and then Goresh.
Okay, I noticed on your slide, Bernie, this is for both Nathan and Bernie, I just thought. on your slide, one of your bullets was Chairman Mao's great leap forward, the famine in China, 58, 63, somewhere in there, as many as 60 million people died. And it was just one of 12 or 15 points that you made. I'd like both of you to spend 30 seconds, a minute, whatever, deconstructing why 60 million people died in China in the late 50s and early 60s. Was it just a biological consequence of, you know, whatever you want to call it, you know, cycles of weather and whatnot, or was it based in something human? Thank you.
Well, I can go first. My answer is just simple. It's just nature. So there was no purpose. Nothing caused it.
Right. And my answer is it's not just nature. It's human nature. Chairman Mao imposed his selfish and tyrannical will through a dynasty upon hundreds of millions of people. If you read about those who survived it, or their grandparents survived it, you read their stories. This is human evil at its worst. And Mao isn't the only one who has done it. It's human nature, not just nature.
So you're saying God sent that flood then to kill the millions and millions of people? You're saying that was God's plan?
Are we talking about the flood, John?
No, we're talking about...
No, what are we talking about?
The social engineering created by Chairman Mao that killed...
It was one of those on your slide. You just didn't give credit to Mao.
I'm sorry, I was talking about... Okay, I misunderstood your question. I thought you were talking about the flood.
Oh, no, okay. He very clearly said, you didn't say it was Mao, well, but those
would
are
you like
the dates.
Would you like to answer it as you understand
yeah,
it?
Let me, so, yeah, let me rephrase the question. So you're saying the social policies of Mao caused millions, the famine, that's what you're talking about? The famine where millions of people
Historians died. Are in perfect agreement that Chairman Mao, through his actions, caused the death of upwards of 60 million people over the late 50s and early 60s, moved them out of the city. Moved them into communal farms
right.
with no training, and people died by the tens of millions per year.
Okay, so I mean, he could have done that. I don't know.
He did do that.
Okay, so I don't know. Was it?
So I want you to explain is that.
People in power can do bad things. If he has the power to do that, he can do that. Like, look what Hitler did. People can do things like that. If
right.
they're in charge, they have the power.
So Dawkins is wrong. At least your quote of Dawkins is not helpful, it's unhelpful.
How so?
Because Chairman Mao killed a lot of people. Pol Pot killed a lot of people.
How's that against evolution?
You keep separating what humans do to each other and the evolutionary cycle. Then you say you have morals, but if it's just all natural, then we got a problem.
I could agree with you it's an evil action for Mao to kill people and Hitler and all that. I still don't understand what the problem is with my worldview on that.
Well, that is the problem of evil.
Okay, let's go on. John?
Okay. I guess the question is, you're coming at things from the perspective of an individual, but if you look at things from a macro level, have your ideas, the ideas put forth by atheism, have they ever worked on a macro level in a nation, in a society? Think about France, for example. They got rid of the priests, they got rid of the aristocracy, and they even got rid of the lawyers. A good thing.
The latter role. I'm sorry, you don't have to answer my question.
They had to bring back the lawyers, they brought back the church because the society was coming completely unglued morally and ethically. So they had to bring back the church. When you look at history, and you look at the application of your ideas of a society based on atheism.
Okay,
where have they ever worked?
Okay, I'm not really strong in history, but one thing I heard was that, you know, with the French Enlightenment, a lot of that had a big impetus to starting America as a great experiment. And when you look at America, how we rebelled against this church and state, you know, we're going more secular. It seems like the more tightly the church is tied to the state, there's a lot of things were a lot worse, killing people for heresy and all that. So it seems like the more secular you are, the better nation you are, too.
But, hey, Bernie, the question that he's asking you is, can you give us an example where atheism has informed on a macro level in a positive way? Has it built a society? Has it built a nation? Has it built an empire?
Yeah.
That would, in any way, show forth the morals that you're putting forth.
Well, one I've heard, I don't know a lot about this, but one I've heard of an example is Sweden, where they're supposed to have a really high level of atheism there, I guess, and it's supposed to be a pretty advanced society, from what I heard, but I'm not an expert in it.
Yeah, I guess the question is not, are there a lot of atheists in Sweden, but the system, the government and the cultural system, did that come out of an atheistic ideal? And was it the intent? Let's found Sweden as an atheist nation.
I don't know, could it just secularization?
Well, I can assure you that's not the case.
Not the case. No, Sweden
yeah.
was not founded as an atheist nation, mm-hmm. no way.
Maybe it was just secular, very secular, and it kind of led that way to most people being
it has grown into a more secular state, but in its, if you look at the history of the European nations, they are far from secular state.
Yeah. Okay, let's go here, Goresh.
I just have some clarification that I need from both parties. So, Pastor Nathan, first question, the Ten Commandments, does it cover natural calamities?
Well, no, because the Ten Commandments govern moral human behavior. Calamity in the scripture is part of the of the history of this world, and these things are under God's control. So earthquakes, floods, and famines, oftentimes in Scripture, they are described as even wielded by God's very hand, metaphorically speaking, that he has allowed them to happen. Oh, oftentimes it says he's decreed them to happen.
So you also said the answer to evil is God. You have to
Correct.
Seek refuge in God. So you're saying God actually senses the natural calamities and then he wants us to seek refuge in him, and we're not supposed to seek any explanations for that?
That's correct. That's the biblical answer. That's the biblical view. If you want to be a Christian, you have to submit to that and begin to see the world as God sees it. And when you have a difficult time figuring out God on these issues, you cannot raise yourself above God and say, and point the finger at God, because his view is greater, his work is greater, his perspective is broader, and because he is out of space and time, he can see the purpose and work the purpose. To be a Christian is to submit to that.
So
and that's very much the Christian point.
Okay, so it's based on submission, based on faith. It's not necessarily based on understanding what's happening in the moment or ever finding answers.
Yes, as far as God has revealed it to us. So that's why many Christians are fine scientists and many Christians are fine musicians, so on and so forth, fine engineers, fine business people, because they are taking what God has revealed, they are taking what they can do as mere human beings. We're not God. We don't, and we're not judge. And so we do what we can with what has been given to us and what has been revealed to us.
And the other question was not necessarily a question, but the response to one of the questions that was asked before, to Bernie. I just wonder if the distinction between pain and pleasure, I think there was a lot of debate earlier on in response to one of the questions on what the distinction was. Is it the do unto others what you would want others to do unto you as long as you're not a masochist? Is that a good tenet to go with?
Well, yes, see, I said there's three things, and that was one of them. That was reciprocity. So they're two different, totally different things. There's some moral questions. There's all kinds of different kind of moral questions, and so I say I put them through that rubric of three things. Sometimes one of them might be exactly applicable to reciprocity, do unto others as you would want them to do unto you. One of them might be all about individual rights, you know, as long as they're not hurting anybody, let them do it. So the other one could be purely consequential, and some of them are very tricky and they're gray areas. So, but can I have a follow-on question here to clarify something you said earlier with Pastor Nathan?
It'll have to be quick. Yeah, we're gonna.
Well, so for example, you asked about Pastor Nathan about the natural disasters. So like when there was 500,000 that died from the cyclone in Bangladesh, did God send that, or what was going on?
I don't know. That's beyond what he has revealed to me. What I can tell you is that whether or not God is the source or the controller of that, all of us, regardless of our worldview, have to deal with that devastation because it happened to us and to our world community. It doesn't do any good to blame God or to blame the Bangladeshi government or, you know, when Katrina hit, everyone blamed the State Department. They didn't get there soon enough. This is a human trait, all too common. We love to blame.
Can I have an interrupt here? You asked if you could clarify something, then you asked a question, and in doing that, you took question time away, so I'm going to put a stop to it. If you want to clarify, that's fine, but no more questions on the front. I believe Tim was first, and then we'll go over here to the lady, and Kevin has also been waiting. We will get all three of your questions in, okay? I know you've been waiting a long time.
I find it very interesting, Bernie, and I'm learning about your perspective on biological evolution, but I'm surprised that 80% of your presentation on the problem of evil was focused on a topic I didn't think was really that relevant. It appears to me that you think that if you can, you sort of have a trump card, I think, approach, that when things get difficult because you're dealing, you don't understand history very well, for instance, that if you pull out the trump card that I don't believe somebody, sort of straw man, literalist approach to creation and existence of Adam and Eve, therefore, they don't have a position, for the problem of evil, somehow that gives you a better argument for your perspective. It doesn't really. I would suggest that your 3 points, if applied, in a use the word evolution in a different context. Coming to the question of whether laws evolve, and whether in the history of civilization, both of you can comment on the concept that starting with a revealed code, like the Ten Commandments, and evolving through consequential arguments, just like you're talking about, does end up with just community laws, or is starting with no revealed law and trying to build consensus with the same evolutionary approach to law, what does that end up with?
Okay, so to answer your first thing, the reason why I spent so much time on the Adam and Eve thing is not because it was a trump card, but because I know going into this that Pastor Nathan has a proclivity to believe that there is an Adam and Eve. And so I want to go over my out of my way to say that that's not true. I'm going to do the same thing in Portland State with a George Fox University philosophy professor who does, he says he accepts evolution fully, so my presentation is going to be totally different, more on that realm. So that's why this one was targeted that direction. As far as Moses getting laws from divine revelation, I don't think so. I think he got it from other areas there. I think laws did emerge with our brains, basically. And there's a thing called mimetic evolution. Basically, ideas change. They build social structures. They build laws. They build politics. This is why we're making faster and faster computers all the time, because these ideas are evolving. Same thing happens in laws and business.
I'm just asking, essentially, could you comment on whether laws started without a basis in a revealed truth, versus laws having started? I don't think anybody's questioning whether the laws evolved through consequentialism. The question is, where did they start? Okay, that's my question.
It started with all human thought. It didn't start from divine. I don't think there's such a thing as divine revelation. I think people came up with laws and said, oh, you better obey this because God gave them to me. And if you don't, you're going to die because that's God's command. It's a good way to enforce your laws by claiming they came from God. But I think like the Code of Hammurabi or whatever was before that, and I think if you look into it, you can see how Moses didn't come up with anything original too much.
Okay. Cool. I have a question about the, I guess the biblical answer to the problem of evil, and the answer was from God saying, hey, who are you to question me? And so the answer to that seems to me to be saying, you can't possibly know what good and bad is. I only know what good and bad is, and just do what I say, because I am all-powerful and almighty. Isn't that the ultimate might makes right argument for good and evil?
No, not at all. The problem with the questioning of God is the human assumption that I am not part of the problem, that I understand the problem, and you might be, God, part of the problem. So I'm asking you to defend yourself. And this is what God refuses to do, is defend himself. He does not need to defend himself. He's God.
Because he's mighty. He says, you can't say, I ordered all the killings, all the rapings, all the wars and everything. Don't you dare question me because I am God?
Yeah, that's correct. That's the biblical view. That's right. If you want to be a Christian, you have to submit to that God is infinitely just, infinitely right in every situation, and that he's the one who gets to ask us about what we have done wrong or what we have done right. That's why the scripture concludes with saying that on the final day of judgment, God will ask us about what we have done right or wrong. If your faith is in Christ, the righteous one, then the answer is, I'm united to him by faith.
So if I am not sure whether raping is good or not, when I look to the Bible and go, what is God's view on this?
That's correct.
And I say, well, he ordered the rape of a bunch of people.
No, but he never did that. He never ordered the rape of anybody. You need to read the Bible. The Mosaic law, for example, prohibits rape.
I think the distinction here, if we can go on, but there is a difference that we're making between moral evil and catastrophes. You can't lump those together.
No, I'm not talking about catastrophes. I'm talking about...
She said rape.
And killing and stuff. But it seems to me that God, when God does stuff, it's okay because it's God, but if we do it, it's not okay, and I'm not...
Well, that's not true, because we all believe in just war. We believe that it was right to go to war against Hitler, do we not? My wife's Armenian. She is altogether glad and elated that just 2 years ago, the Turkish government finally admitted that they slaughtered 2 million Armenians. And the Armenians have every right in their day in 1906 to 1908 to marshal the troops that they did not have to fight against the Turks. We can all imagine at least a just war. God does command just wars. And so people who...
We only have, at this point, 6 more minutes.
Can I say 10 seconds?
All right, go ahead.
If I was really powerful and had godlike powers, though, I wouldn't say, make a war where innocent people get killed. I'd kind of go, okay, all the bad people are defeated and all the good people aren't.
Yeah, that's right, Julia, but you're not God. And I'm not God. You're making my point very well. God alone is God. He alone is God. That's the Christian, that's the Jewish response. The Jewish confession for millennia has been, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. The Christians have picked that up.
Just quick, if it's related.
If you can make it really quick, I want to respect these guys who have been standing up a long time.
Yeah, I just want to say the funny thing about Job is, Job says, what's going on here? And God says, none of your business, basically. Who are you to judge me? But the thing is, the reader is told the reason why Job went through all that, just to test his faith. Now, if God would have said, oh, Job, the reason why I did this was to test your faith, I could imagine Job saying, oh, you blanky, blanky, blank, you know, talking back to him. But it's like, he didn't tell him the truth, so it's like, okay.
All right, so this kind of plays off that question a little bit. So, Pastor Nathan, you were saying that the real difficulty with evil from an atheist viewpoint is that there's no such thing as a catastrophic evil because it's all probabilities and, you know, the universal will and say things like that, right? But with catastrophes from the theistic point of view, you're saying the same thing. There is no such thing as an evil because it's God, right?
No, not at all. Evil is anything that goes against God's law.
Oh, okay. So drawing the two distinctions between catastrophic evil and human evil, so the actor, you know, in your case, the actor for catastrophic evil would be God. The universe, you know, probabilities would be the atheistic. So, but in human evil, I think we can both agree, you know, the atheistic viewpoint is human evil would be people harming others for no good reason, I suppose, right? No good reason.
And that's where it really breaks down, and that's why you need God. Even though God is at the center of the problem of evil, because he's the one who whips up the storm,
you're right.
He is also the solution to the problem of human evil. He is the solution. He's the redeemer. He's the restorer. He's the reconciler. That's why you need God. Without him, the problem of evil is that humanity will continue to destroy this environment, will continue to destroy each other, will devour each other. Without God, we won't be able to say, come, let's reason together. Okay? We're beyond that. Humanism has had, 400 years now and has proven that it just isn't going to work.
Finalize your question.
Yeah, so actually, just playing off that one, so you were saying humanism has not seen, and I mean, I'm going to use evolution here in a kind of relative term, but it hasn't advanced human morals you were saying? But I would argue...
The 20th century was the bloodiest century in Western civilization.
In terms of numbers?
Not the 100-year war, not right. the 30-year war.
In percentage, has it been, though? I mean...
Oh, absolutely. Not only in percentage, but in deviancy. The 20th century... Just read about what happened in the 20th century. Maybe you're like Bernie, you don't know your history. The 20th century was a bloody, cruel history.
Yeah, but how about this?
Hold on, I want to make sure he's finished his question.
I want to respond to that comment, actually.
Yeah, no, I'd like to hear Bernie's response.
Okay. Look at the world today. The major superpowers are not at war. This is an amazing thing. This is the most peaceful time ever. There's always been wars. We have technology now to wipe out each other, and we have it. That's why the death counts are so much recently, because of the weapons of mass destruction. But look at where we are now. This is amazing. There's no time in the world where, if you want to know about history, look at our time now compared to history. Isn't that a no-brainer? It's much more painful.
I think you need to get out of the world more.
Okay, so, I want to make sure you've got your question finished.
Yeah, I suppose.
Are you sure?
Well. Actually, Bernie, I mean, you kind of said it perfectly. We have these massive weapons, just like in World War II, you know, the bloodiest war ever, right? Because we have the technology to do so. Because we have the technology to carpet bomb and things like that. We now have thermonuclear weapons that can wipe out entire countries, yet we choose to not use them. And anti-theism is on the rise, yet we still don't use them. I mean, I can't coincide one thing with the other from your standpoint. Why is it that we are becoming more secular on, you know, at least in the Western world, probably in the Eastern world, yet we still choose to not use these weapons that could, you know, in one blast, wipe out more than all of World War II combined?
Well, I guess all I can tell you is just stay tuned. And live a little bit longer of life and get out of the world more.
Okay.
This world is fraught with a lot of problems.
Bethany, and I'm only going to add, I'm going to cut this off quick. Can you make one succinct question for one person, and this will be the last one?
So, Bernie, I was wondering if by your definition of someone being more moral or not, you know, which is that their consequences of their actions turn out giving more pleasure. Are there people who are more evil or more good than others?
Yeah, I mean, if somebody goes around hurting people, they're not as good as another person who goes around helping everybody, sure.
Pastor Nathan
could
also respond if we have time. That'd be interesting.
Would you say the question again?
Are there people more good or evil than others? Or is it?
No, based on what the Apostle Paul says in Romans 3, there's no one righteous. No, not one. Because I'm a minister of the gospel, I am not morally better than anyone else. I can't stand before God and say, because I did this, 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 and did not do this, this, and this, you know, you need to, you know, cut me some slack or reward me. The only person who is out of that loop is the Lord Jesus Christ.
I was also going to ask, I forgot to add and why to Bernie, like why are some people more good or more evil than others?
I mean, to me it's just kind of obvious if somebody's going around the neighborhood and beating everybody up, and the other person's going around helping everybody, you're going to say, I like that person, he's a good person, that person's a bad person. I mean, we're not speaking different languages, everybody knows what's going on.
Well, is it because they evolved to be more a good person, or what is it because, what do you mean?
So that's probably not my specialty, that's more a psychoanalysis, I think, but I mean, people are part of their DNA, it's part of how they were raised, and part of their environment, so.
So some people are more psychologists, we have to put a close to it.
Last time we went too long, and I got some feedback that we need to be precise, because we are a very mixed group here tonight. So thank you all. It's been very interesting. I want to give a round of applause for a few people.